Good evening, everyone. It is Saturday, August 8th, and this is an update on our efforts to get an extension to the payroll support program. So I want to be very clear that our payroll support extension enjoys the bipartisan support of both the House and Senate. At this point in time, earlier in this week, in just a 24-hour period, there were 16 Republican senators who signed a letter in support of the payroll support program extension to preserve our jobs, stop involuntary furloughs, ensure there are no cuts to hourly rates, and to maintain service to all of our communities so that during this time airlines are not cutting routes that are not profitable, and we are continuing all that service to all of our communities and keeping us in our jobs. So 16 Republican senators signed that letter, went on record supporting that. That added to the Democrats who had made this a proposal in these negotiations, took us well over 60 senators in support. At this point in time, I should let you know that we enjoy more than 80 senators who support our efforts to achieve the extension of the payroll support program, and there is no one who is against it. The only party that has said no to it so far is Secretary Mnuchin and Mark Meadows representing the White House. So in these negotiations, they were continuing over this weekend. There is some chatter that Congress has left and gone home. That's not true, actually. Both Democrats and Republicans, the committees of jurisdiction over different areas of the coronavirus relief that is being negotiated, were meeting and talking about the specifics and how they would start to put together some of the specifics that affect different areas. I want us to remember that this coronavirus relief is bigger than us. It is about making sure that our small communities and states have enough funding to continue to operate. That things like rural hospitals don't shut down because the funding is not there, so we're making sure that is shored up. There are a lot of issues to deal with, making sure that we have a child care system that is available so that people who are able to work can work, making sure that we have an extension of the expanded unemployment benefits because tens of millions of people are out of work. And it is not that they are refusing to go to work, it's that there is no work for them to go to. Of course, we know that that would be true for us as well if it were not for the payroll support program that has kept us in our jobs and kept our airlines intact. And in fact, if we did not have the payroll support program, and even those of us who have contributed by taking voluntary furloughs have used that, and I should say that the people who have contributed in that way as airline employees, also some of them, it would be very difficult to go to work during this time. As we heard last week, there's a flight attendant who has her husband is waiting for a heart transplant. To go to work during this time would be incredibly risky and put her husband's life in jeopardy. Being able to continue her medical benefits keeps them on a list for that heart transplant. Everyone has a story, but we are in the middle of a pandemic, in the middle of a crisis, and it is a crisis that our country has not faced in over 100 years. Congress has the power of the purse. The federal government has the ability to allocate money without taxing. They don't have to tax and bring that in first. They can allocate money to shore this up, and it is important that that is happening. For example, our payroll support program, that was funded with $25 billion. That was something that the federal government invested, and that actually comes back because that has come back through those of us who have paid taxes on that money that we have been getting and in the way that we have spent into the economy and in the services and the resources that were pumped back into our economy with our airlines continuing to operate. So there's 100% return on that investment, but you don't have to tax first to get that. But if you don't spend up front, then you have a much bigger bill because people get evicted from their homes because they're not able to pay their rent and their debt piles up and they're not able to pay their credit card bills and their student debt. And there are fees that go on top of that. And it makes it much harder for the entire economy to recover when you're not spending upfront. So that's sort of the basic concept going on here, is that we're in the middle of this crisis. There are people who, through no fault of their own, are out of work and need some help right now. We also have people who are getting sick, whose family members are getting sick, and they need some extra support. So let's stay focused. The president announced this afternoon that he was signing executive orders. So first of all, this doesn't cover all the issues that I've just been identifying. It does not cover our payroll support extension. So if those executive orders were to just stay in place, by the way, there was a $400 instead of $600 plus up on the unemployment benefits, but 25% of that is supposed to be covered by the states. I want us to remember that in these discussions, a big part of the discussions and something that Congress was working on was getting money to the state and local governments that don't have the money to continue the services that are necessary to keep the communities safe and to continue to provide medical support for the communities. So, and also we have had many, many reports from you, those of you who have been on unemployment, who have not been able to get it, who have been denied, who have been caught up in a system where the system is not working. So saying that it's going to be a $400 instead of $600 doesn't fully cover people's costs. And then saying that the states are going to pay for 25% of that just doesn't work. So let me just say clearly, it doesn't really, we don't need to spend a lot of time on that. It's not really necessary to spend a lot of time on it. What we can know is that we, as airline employees, airline workers with a plan that has been the best jobs program in all of the coronavirus relief, enjoy incredible bipartisan support. And if Congress does its job and actually passes a bill with that in it, then we have that support. We are incredibly organized. We are organized with the rest of our unions. Our airlines have now joined us in this effort, in our proposal for this extension, and they are fully behind us. Our airlines are in this with us. And so our entire industry is united behind getting this payroll support extension. And we need to stay focused on that. We stand in solidarity with our sisters and brothers. For example, the 600,000 workers at the United States Postal Service who count on their paychecks and their jobs and their health care benefits by doing the work at the United States Postal Service, such an essential service for our veterans who get the majority of their medicine through the mail, our seniors, connecting our rural communities, and also supporting those good union jobs. So we support all of these things that Congress is working on to shore up all of our communities and take care of all of our friends and neighbors. We absolutely do. But if we focus on the fact that we have support from Congress for our proposal and simply ask Congress to take back control of these negotiations. Mitch McConnell outsourced these negotiations to Secretary Mnuchin and Mark Meadows, and he, as the Senate leader, can simply take that back and negotiate a deal. The Democrats have already come down $1 trillion in their proposal. There is a deal to be had here that meets in the middle with both parties, covers these critical programs that need to be covered, includes our payroll support extension, and that can absolutely happen. And I just want to remind you how quickly things can happen. During the government shutdown, when Congress voted not to pass a proposal to reopen the government, and just a day later, after flights started to cancel in LaGuardia, and we were saying that we were going to stand up for our sisters and brothers in air traffic control and the TSA workers, Just 24 hours later, actually, the Senate and the House came to agreement, voted, and reopened the government. That's how quickly this can come together. And I want you to know, anyone who is saying that Congress is on vacation right now, not doing work, I know that both Democrats and Republicans are at work right now in DC. How do I know? Because I'm talking to them. I'm talking to them. And we need to ask our senators and members of the House as well to take control of this process. It's Congress's job to allocate money into these budgets, to put together the spending bills that are necessary. That is their job. That's their constitutional job. And so all they have to do is do their job. And we have to keep calling and ask them to do that job. They can do it. This is not an extraordinary thing to ask. It is the right thing to do. It's what we need to have happen. And if it doesn't happen, just on the example of us alone in the airline industry, hundreds of thousands of jobs are on the line. We will not be able to build our airlines back up fast enough to be able to compete with the rest of the world on the other side of this pandemic. And in the meantime, our small communities are in jeopardy of losing service, which will also continue to erode the network and further put our jobs in jeopardy. So we need Congress to act right now, and they can. I want you to burn up the phone lines. I want you to tweet at your members of Congress. Help them understand that we know that they have this responsibility and they can take this responsibility right now to get this right. We can get this done. They are here. They are working. Their staff is working around the clock. I know this. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. This can be fixed right now. But we have to let them know that we are paying attention, that we appreciate their support, but they need to see it through to getting a bill done now. So we can do this. Keep up your calls. It's critically important. And we, as an airline industry, can help the rest of the country as well. Because as we shore up our jobs, we'll be shoring up all of our communities too. So, thank you very much, everybody. Stay tuned. I'm going to again put the call numbers and the scripts, but I want you to know that you can also be, again, tweeting at your representatives, okay? You can also write letters to the editor in your local newspaper. That's another way that you can contribute. If you can't get through on the numbers that we're providing, you can look up your representative's numbers very easily on the internet. Just go to senate.gov or house.gov and look up your members' contact information. You can call their local offices, not just their Washington, D.C. offices. So these are all the things that you can be doing. But get the word through, help them know we're paying attention. The election's in the fall, and it's not just a presidential election. It's an election for many of our senators and all of the members of the House, and we expect them to do their job and get this bill done so that we can make sure that millions of people all across this country are not hurting, that our jobs are saved, that our industry stays intact, and that we can recover from this pandemic. So, thanks everybody. We will continue to keep you advised, but keep the faith, spread the word, and keep up your action. Because if anyone can do it, flight attendants can do it. If any industry can stick together and make this work and get us back up in the air, our airline industry can do it. Let's do this together. Thanks, everybody, and stay tuned. Keep acting.